Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear beautiful people, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. My brothers and my sisters, from now and then, every now and then, someone sends me a message and he goes, you know, I'm having problems, I'm having difficulties, and they don't seem to be going away. And it amuses me when people say this, really does. And when I say people, regardless of their beliefs. Because, look at this way here. When Allah gives us a toothache, all humans, we share the pain. We all are in tears, in agony. We cry, we take medication. We all deal with that pain. But we all share one thing is, it's a pain. It really is a physical pain. Or if somebody has got stones in their kidneys, it is painful. Oh, yes, it is painful. However, these are physical pains and we all respond to them equally, to a certain degree. Women have more pain threshold than men, believe it or not. But we men have our strength somewhere else. Okay, sisters, please think good of us. But emotional and how we deal with issues depends on you. We all have problems. We all have problems. Some of us surrender to problems and we get so much so underneath our problems that our problems look, seem, sound like the huge, gigantic mountain on top of us. When we look at them from down to up. That is a huge, big problem. You can't deal with it. But you have another expression that I always teach people, and alhamdulillah, I use. And that is mind over matter. What does mind over matter mean? Means when you get a problem, I'm going to talk first of all to a non-Muslim, and then I'll turn back to Muslim. When I do coaching and I work with businesses, or work with people who need help with their problems, I tell them, we got to play the mind over matter, what it is. I take whichever example that is, like this gentleman here that talked to me yesterday about problems with him and his wife and the kids. There is a hadith, but I'll come back to that later. But when I talk to non-Muslims, I actually practice the hadith without telling them that it is the hadith. I just put the theory there, put all my weight behind it, push it, and it yields results. So mind over matter. When a problem occurs to you, you've got two ways of looking at the problem. The way you look at the problem will actually bring in 50% of the solution. If you look at the problem as, ha, it's a challenge, it's a situation, it's just one of those things where I am facing an obstacle, and I gotta find a way on how to go beyond and above this obstacle. The brain interacts with you and starts looking for those solutions that will help you go beyond or surpass or go up that issue. Lo and behold, you will find yourself, you've gone past them. Emotional damage? None. Because you approach this situation from a challenge. Challenge creates that external energy, that beautiful positive energy. I can do that. And then you go and do it. To a Muslim now, I come to a Muslim, when a Muslim says, I have a problem, guess what I tell him? Islamically speaking, mind over matter. Exactly what I tell the non-Muslim. Because my brothers and my sisters, we Muslims, you're supposed to have that extra ingredient that is Iman, in how we interact with our problems. As I said earlier on, there is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in which he says, three things that if we did them, peace of mind. For instance, that Allah will not accept the dua of three people. It don't matter when do you make that dua, how much you make it, whatever you do, Allah will not accept it. One of them, if you lend money to somebody and they don't return it to you and you make dua to Allah, Allah will not accept your dua against them on one condition. If you don't write down the deal, then you have no right to go back to Allah and say, Ya Allah, I lent them money and they didn't return it to me. Your evidence, what is the contract? If you provide something in written that you lent this person $200 and the witnesses are witness A and B, and if they are women, so it's a one man and two women. And I've already spoken about the issue. It doesn't lessen the woman. It just takes the emotionality into account. Now, when you have written that and you bring it forth, and if you have written it and you make dua against the person, then Allah will answer your dua, because you have taken in the suggestion of Allah to write it down. Second one, that Allah will not accept your dua against them, and this might surprise you, your wife or your husband. In the sense that if your wife is a bad, evil wife, giving you headaches, not fulfilling her responsibilities as a spouse, as a partner, you know you can divorce her. You can. But you don't do it. You can't go to Allah and make dua against her, because Allah has provided you with a solution. Why aren't you taking advantage of the solution? I hear you say kids are involved. Now, my question to you is, what angle are you looking at the kids? Because a lot of times people think, like, if I abandon my kids, my children are not going to be taken care of and blah, blah, blah. This is where the shirk kicks in. So, if your wife is evil and is not, or doesn't love you, doesn't interact with you, is not fulfilling her right, she's a piece of rock in the bedroom, emotionally she's a refrigerator, and her mouth is just like the sewer, nothing good comes out of it, divorce her. Don't stay with her and pray to Akhi, I am observing patience, sabr, and I make dua to Allah, guide her. That's what she is. She is evil with you. That's who she is. Allah tells you, divorce her. Same thing for the husband, my sister. If your husband is not fulfilling his duties and is not the man that is there for you, does not satisfy you in the bedroom, is not the loving, is not there, you can make 1,000 dua for him. It's not going to work. Why? Because Allah has given you the way out from that solution. Let's apply this to any other ways. When you, my brothers and my sisters, face a problem, you have got to bring your mind over matter. You have to look at the problem, no matter how big it is, as what? As a challenge. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا حَزَبَهُ أَمَرْ فَزِعَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Whenever a problem occurred to Rasulullah, the first thing that he did, two rakat, he goes straight away to Salat, talks to Allah, grounds himself, puts himself in that psyche of mind over matter, and seek the help with Allah. And guess what? Little after that, you find that actually that was not a problem. So if you come, I take three people, and I bring the same problem and tell them, how do you feel about the problems? The three of them will have different opinions about the problem. To one of them, it could be like the end of the world. To the other one, it's no big deal. To the other one, it just needs a little bit and I can get it sorted out. But if you give the three people a toothache, nobody's going to say it's a piece of cake. We all are going to cry. The pep talk today is about how true and how real are you at looking at the challenges that Allah throws in your way to make you a better person. Perhaps for that wife that is evil, or for the husband that is evil, perhaps your risk for these two children to come to earth was through this man or through this woman. It don't mean you have to waste the rest of your life with her. Because if you marry another woman, and if you marry another man, there are other children that are waiting for you with that woman. And there are other children that are waiting for you with the other man. So why are you sitting home crying that I'm having problems? when the solution is in your hands? Or are you perhaps scared of losing your home, your flat? Or perhaps are you just too much used to the comfort of home? Are you really scared of seeing the man go and being alone and single again? So it's not the problem that is the real issue. It's what you are going to lose temporarily as you kick the butt of that challenge. You gotta be honest with yourself. You gotta be honest with yourself. Who are you really serving? Your own needs or your own greeds? Before I end my pep talk about these kind of problems and situations, let me tell you this. Maybe it helps you in your life. If you always see you are going through the same problems, know this. Problems are a creation just like you, meaning they have an entity, they have a body. It's just you can't see them. Just like the air you breathe, the pain you feel, it's there, but you can't put your fingers on it. Problems love the weak people. They love the people who are under the pressure of a problem. When a problem wants to hit people and hit them, what it does, it looks who is the weakest link in the mankind structure. And then it sees you and it goes, that man or that Muslim woman there or that guy there actually is weak, and I can go to them and I can wreak havoc in their lives. And problem falls you one after time, after time, after time. Notice how problems keep coming to you. And perhaps there was a time in your life where you were gone for a month or two without a single problem. Ask yourself, why did that happen? Yes, it's Allah who has written. But since we don't know why Allah writes this, why they come to you and not to your next door neighbor, we gotta start dealing with the problems with a complete different vision, all of this under the banner of Tawheed. I refuse to let problems wreak havoc in my life. Qadarullah, what Allah has written, I don't know what He has written. But why do I always assume it's negative? Why do I always assume it's bad? Why do I always assume it's my doom? Why don't I be somebody more positive? Why don't I think good of Allah and say, what He has written for me is good. What He has written for me is better. What He has written for me is bigger. I'm gonna go and get the big and bad. Remember, every day when Allah gives you life, He gives you two choices, and it's yours what you make out of them. You can be under the matter or above the matter. Just know you can do both with your mind. Once the mind does something, the rest of the body follows. After all, it's because you believed that you prostrate in your salat. You don't prostrate and then you believe. It's because your mind has believed, your mind has prostrated, your body follows. Problems love the weak. That's why they stay with them. They find comfort with them. They keep nagging you. And Shaytan loves that to no end. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Kick the problems where it hurts and stand up. Stand up as a giant. Dust yourself off and look where your destiny leads you to positivity. If your husband is giving you a headache, divorce him and go marry somebody else. Plenty of joy out there. And if your wife is giving you a headache, divorce her and go look for beauty and love elsewhere. Don't stay for a split of a second under the wrath of your own thoughts. Mind over matter means mind over matter. I leave you with this thought in mind. Mind over matter is what you need to be doing from now until you meet Allah. Put your heart and mind over any matter and see how they become minuscule. They will become like a mosquito. All you gotta do is take a mosquito killer, swallow them, stuff, dead. Problems are here to make your life spicy. After all, a blunt dish doesn't have any taste. A spicy dish is yummy, 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 makes me sweat. Problems are the dishes that are without the spices, not at all. Problems are spices. Just have a good dish so that they give a nice flavor to that dish, which is called your life. my brothers and my sisters, you have an utterly awesome day today, and be good. This is again your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. I pray to Allah to save us all from the calamities of falling short to our greed. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuhu.